Well, thank you so much for having me here, Lorenzo and Andre. And thank you all of you for listening on a Friday morning. It's beautiful space as well. So I changed my title a little bit to Deep Sea Mining and the Protection of Marine Biodiversity to be more aligned with the Law of the Sea Convention. But I'm not a lawyer. I'm a marine biologist and, as Lorenzo said, a trained communicator as well. So I have a little outline for my presentation. As you can see here, I talk first about what is the deep sea. You may not all know exactly what it is, other than that it's deep. And then I'm going to go into a few words about what deep sea mining is, the impacts on biodiversity and on ecosystem services. That's very important, ecosystem services, what we get out of the ocean. Touching on UNCLOS and Part 11, and also talk a little bit about what actually happened at the latest ISA meeting. And then talk about the protection of the marine environment and ecosystems and the moratorium movement, which is gaining speed over the last couple of years. And finalize with a little bit of a setting of the context more broadly around the discussions around deep sea mining and the need for minerals from the deep sea. And please let me know if I touch the end, right, a little bit before I touch the end. So first, what is the deep sea? It's waters below 200 meters. And of course, it's also the seabed beyond the continental shelves in terms of the area. It is 90% of the living space in the ocean. So it's most of the space is vast. And of course, it's deep. It has very many features. It has hydrothermal vents. It has seamounts and seamount chains. It has the vast abyssal plains, trenches, and it's cold. And the environment in most of these places is constant over probably hundreds of thousands or more years. Except it can also be violent, as can be the case around hydrothermal vents. The water is also not homogeneous in the deep sea. We have currents and upwellings. We have cold water seeps. We have the vast mesopelagic zone, which we just start to understand. And this kind of includes also the twilight zone, which is a really interesting area for biodiversity. It is one of the most inaccessible and unexplored areas of our planet. Sometimes we talk about it as being less known than the moon. We are maybe just catching up on that now with new deep sea remotely operated vehicles, etc. It supports a vast diversity of species and ecosystems that are adapted to this unique environment, and they're highly vulnerable to human disturbance. And this is why, why is this? It's because the deep sea has been untouched for so long. The environment in most places has been stable for so long. And if something is stable, evolution goes very slow, which means that the systems and the species down there can't really cope with any change. So that's important to understand in the context of the onset of potential seabed mining. It is also playing a vital role in regulating our planetary systems, including the carbon cycle, which of course then touches on other presentations here in terms of climate change. And it's also provide the basis of the food chain in the ocean, and as such also actually for many of us. There was a new groundbreaking study that was published only last month. We're still in August, right? So last month, in Nature Geoscience, a highly prestigious academic journal. And this study reveals that oxygen is being produced in the deep sea. Now, there's no light in the deep sea, right? It's totally dark. So this is a new process that is associated with a very substrate that is being targeted by seabed mining, the polymetallic nodules in the seafloor of the Pacific Ocean. So this is happening in complete absence of sunlight. It just shows us how little we know about the deep sea and what the importance of the deep sea, what it plays, that important role it plays for the planet as a whole. So what's deep seabed mining? Well, it's kind of a bit speculative because deep seabed mining isn't happening at the moment, right? But what the deep sea mining industry is looking at, and also some countries are looking at, is to exploit the very metal-rich mineral deposits in the deep sea. And these are found in both the abyssal plains and the seamounts, and also at hydrothermal vents. We're looking at copper, cobalt, nickel, and manganese, and other substances. And these are, of course, used in your mobile phones. They're used in electric vehicle batteries. They are used in the renewable energy sector, in wind turbines, for example. But they can also be used in weapons, which I think we shouldn't forget. So in a lot of different industrial and electronic applications, you can find these minerals. So deep sea mining involves retrieving these mineral-rich deposits from the deep sea. That sounds clean, right? But what it does actually mean is to take away that substrate, which is the basis of a lot of marine life and processes in the ocean. And we should remember that these deep sea minerals are part of the marine environment, and they form habitats and they provide services for us and for the ocean and planet as a whole. If deep sea mining starts, one deep sea mining operation will probably go on for 30 years or more, and it will run for 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And it's deep down there, which means that it's a lot of pressure, which means that there's also a lot of technological issues in the development of the technology, which is part of why we're not there yet with seabed mining, but the other part is obviously the legal context here. Did I press the button on it? Then we should. There we go. Sometimes it's slow. Okay, so what would deep sea mining do to ocean life, to the mostly unknown ocean life on the deep floor, but also to the broader marine life that's traveling through our oceans? As I mentioned most recently, the dark oxygen paper provides yet another issue of what seabed mining could impact, that is oxygen production. And of course, the deep sea is very fragile. And almost, I think you could probably safely say that every cruise that goes to look into the deep sea fauna, there is no flora in the deep sea, finds new species. So destruction of habitats, the extinction of species at the local level. But there's also a lot of endemism in the deep sea. Endemism means that species are only found in one particular place. And if you mine such a place, those species are gone. And of course, these operations would also have an impact on the ecosystem in which these species live, taking away the very habitat, the living space for these species. And all methods of exploitation that are currently being looked at involve habitat destruction. There's nothing like picking up potatoes in the deep sea, as some say. Sediment disruption. The deep sea floor is covered by a deep sediment layer, which has been formed over millennia and millennia through what's called marine snow. Little pieces of marine organisms that slowly, slowly fall down to the deep sea and settle there. And this sediment could drift far, very, very far from the mining site, and it would impact the breathing of marine animals and also the feeding of marine animals. There's also wastewater from the ships, because seabed mining has to take place from a ship. There's a ship at the surface, seabed mining vehicles on the seafloor. This wastewater that comes, so basically that is like a pipe. You can see on the picture, there's like a pipe going down, sucking up the nodules and the plumes, or the sediment. But then the sediment has no place on the vessel, so it will be pushed back out into the sea at a level of depth that is not yet determined. But wherever it's being dumped, it will spread through the currents and have impact. There's also studies saying that this might be toxic, and also that at least some of the nodules have levels of radioactivity that are also quite concerning. There's a lot of issues to think about. But then there's noise and light pollution as well. The light pollution is obviously mostly from the vessel on the surface, but it might also be on the seafloor, because somehow the activity on the seafloor needs to be measured or monitored from the vessel so that you can see where these machines are going. And it's dark down there, so light is also a big factor that affects communications. Many deep sea animals communicate by emitting light and searching for light to find a partner and find food, for example. And the same goes for noise. Noise in the ocean travels much, much further than the noise that we hear around us. And so a noise from a mining operation or from ships, by the way, travel very, very far. We know already that whales, for example, who navigate a lot through hearing, they have problems in the sea as it is today to find their youngs, to get together, to find partners, to reproduce, etc. So that's also an important factor. And then, as I said, the discovery of dark oxygen is a really profound new discovery, and I think we can expect more such discoveries as more science is being conducted. And this could have severe implications for the future of deep sea mining, and surely would require further investigation and verification as well, more papers to be produced, etc. Impacts on fisheries as well. So this particular sector would also impact on other sectors of which humanity depends and entire communities depend. And here particularly important is probably the small island developing states we were talking about before, who many of them get both income and food and livelihoods from fisheries. So seabed mining would be disruptive, and perhaps a really important factor here is also that any kind of recovery of these deep sea systems would occur on timescales that are not timescales that we understand as humans. So very, very long time, if at all. So, you know I'm not a lawyer, so I won't talk too much about UNCLOS, but the discussions around seabed mining in international waters obviously take place under UNCLOS at the International Seabed Authority, which was established by UNCLOS and just celebrated its 30th anniversary. And the Seabed Authority has been set up to oversee mining in international waters. It is the custodian of the legal regime that pertains to what's called the area that was mentioned before, Part 11 of UNCLOS. But it does not, Part 11 does not apply to the water column. So there also are other aspects that have to be included here. One issue about the law of the sea was that when it was negotiated, and Andre said 1982 was a really important year for the Law of the Sea Convention, there was very little, if any, knowledge of the deep sea, let alone any around how the ocean spaces are connected, the connectivity and the migration and various other processes that are happening in our oceans. And we knew nothing about climate regulation, of course, at that point from the ocean, or very, very little. So there's a lot that has happened during this time. And of course, the Law of the Sea is more of sort of a framework convention. So there's lots you can use the Law of the Sea, but then there's a lot of other issues that have to come in. And Ximena in particular spoke a lot about science, and listening to science is really important. Another aspect of the Part 11 is the common heritage of what's now called humankind. It was mankind in 1982, but things have actually moved on, so now we call it humankind. And this is a really, really important principle. It belongs, the deep sea and its resources belong to all of us, but it also belongs to our children and grandchildren and so forth into the future. So how on earth do we manage to mine this area for finite resources at the same time as preserving it for the future? It's a bit of a dilemma. And then, of course, also was mentioned before, the precautionary principle that is to be applied in the absence of knowledge. That's also another important part that is behooved upon decision makers to think about when we think about seabed mining. So the ISA has a dual role, which some think is a conflict of interest, or could be a conflict of interest. It is tasked with protecting the marine environment and ensuring that mining benefits humanity as a whole. And ISA is both a regulator, but also in the future could be a beneficiary, actually is a beneficiary of mining, or could be when if mining starts, because some of the proceeds from deep sea mining would go to the International Seabed Authority. Thirdly, the ISA would establish the enterprise, which is like a mining arm of an international regulatory body, which also is slightly odd, in my view. Also, the ISA structure in decision-making tends to favor, at the moment, exploration, as exploitation isn't happening, but the same structures are there also for the next phase. Not a single, I'm lying now, but I'm saying it first and then I have a caveat. Not a single exploration license has been refused by the International Seabed Authority. There's one now that's pending. India submitted two license applications in the spring, because one of those has to do with a extended continental shelf claim between Sri Lanka and India. So you can't solve that before that claim is solved. But that has nothing to do with what's going on in the deep sea in terms of environmental issues or other issues. It's a purely delimitation issue, that one. As I said, no seabed mining is taking place today. But ISA has entered into, as it should and could, 15-year contracts, and there are 30 of those that are currently active with 22 different contractors. Some are state contractors, others are contractors that have sponsoring states, so they will be for private companies that have a sponsoring state, and as such then get a license to explore for minerals, which also includes conducting or enabling research to be conducted on their ships, and then reported back to the ISA.
I have another slide. Do I have another slide on that?
Yes.
Okay. So, just a few words on the state of play and the current situation at the International Seabed Authority. You may have heard about one member state triggering what is called the two-year rule under the Law of the Sea Convention. 3 years ago now, so the two-year rule has expired. This two-year rule was negotiated in order to make sure that a state that had a company who wanted to go mine in the absence of finalized and adopted regulations could do so if there was a real blocking of the development of the regulations. This was triggered in the middle of the pandemic. And so has been seen by some as politically not terribly kind, but so be it. The two-year rule were triggered and it expired. The ISA member states were kind of, I wouldn't say taken, but they were taken by surprise by the triggering of the two-year rule, and they didn't really know what to do about it. And I think it's not clear yet what actually to do, whether if a license is being submitted in the absence of regulations. But that's hanging there as a bit of a stressor on the negotiations, on the regulations that are underway at Council at the ISA. But what was clear was that last year states clearly said that they do not wish to grant an exploitation license without the rules or the regulations and standards and guidelines in place. And this was clearly stated last year. We have another slide.
Oh, okay. Let's go back. The issue with the regulations is that the regulations cover a lot of different issues, environmental, of course, but also the sharing of proceeds from mining, both how they should be shared from the operator
to the ISA, to the member states, etc. There are about 30 big issues outstanding in the regulations, according to a report that was published in March this year. So there's a long way to go already before any regulations could be finalized. And then, of course, there's also this huge lack of science in this regard. There's a lot of politics at the ISA as well, which is interesting when you go to international conferences and negotiations. There's quite different dynamics in different organizations, and this organization has a particular dynamic. Indigenous people's voices are started to be heard at the ISA. This is a new development across the whole international community, that indigenous people's rights are much more recognized now in international law and covenants. And this is now also being seen at the International Seabed Authority. But just so you know, the indigenous peoples are not invited to speak at the ISA. They come on observer delegations in order to have their voices heard in general. But there is also a discussion at the ISA of what's called cultural heritage. And here we have both intangible, so cultural heritage that has to do with beliefs and even the genesis of the planet, and more tangible heritage like shipwrecks, graves, etc. Last year, there was a new item introduced as an idea in the assembly, which was called a general policy to protect the marine environment. And this was introduced by Chile and got the support of about 20 states, and was also discussed at this year's assembly. This is the first time that the protection of the marine environment would get its own agenda item at the assembly. But unfortunately, adding it formally onto next year's agenda was blocked by a few states, and ISA in general operates by consensus, so that agenda item is not there now for next year either. And this has to do with the issue of the regulations not being in place and not being finalized anytime soon, and the two-year rule. So how do we protect the marine environment from potentially unregulated mining should the license be submitted, that's all in discussion. Another interesting development of the International Seabed Authority is that there will be a change to Secretary General. So the incumbent Secretary General, himself for two periods, will be replaced by a new Secretary General who currently works at UNEP. She's Brazilian, will be the first time there'll be a woman, and she's quite young and very dynamic. So, and her idea is to first look at how the ISA functions and is governed. And so that would be interesting also to see how that works. Assembly had quorum, which I believe is for the first time ever since the 30 years in the life of the ISA. So it's clear that seabed mining has become a globally important issue for many more countries than has been the case before. Right. Oop. I'm going too fast. Oop. So this is what you shouldn't do, right? So wait even longer. All right. The protection of the marine environment. Very, very quickly, under the ISA, of course, there have been a lot of efforts to discuss how to protect the marine environment, and there are what's called areas of important environmental AIEPs that have been identified as part of the process of looking at, in particular, the Clarion-Clipperton Zone, which is the first target area for mining in the Pacific. These are, if you look on a map of the Clarion-Clipperton Zone, you would soon discover that they don't really overlap with the claim areas of countries. And what has also been found out is that they are generally where there's less nodules. And as I said, outside the area set aside for mining. So they are potentially not the most important areas for biodiversity to protect. Nonetheless, there are areas that have been identified as as candidate area for protections. And then there's something called regional environmental management plans that have also been developed through an ISA process with workshops with stakeholders, not only states, but also civil society and scientists have been involved in this development of these RMPs. But there's a fundamental problem, which is that it's really impossible to manage an activity for impact if you don't know what the baseline is. And because there's so little known about the deep sea, you can't really develop management measures that would help prevent harm to the marine environment from an activity. So, and this also then, of course, is almost like a circular argument when I talk about the regulations. Because in the regulations there are issues such as, there's development of thresholds, for example, and what is the acceptable level of harm to the marine environment from mining. And without science, you actually cannot establish any of this. So it's a little bit of a circular argument. Interesting. Okay. Stop now. So I wanted to talk a little bit about one alternative to how to protect the marine environment in absence of science. And this is being promoted by civil society, by scientists, and now also increasingly countries. So I'll go through that quickly. It's really about applying the precautionary approach or principle to mining, saying that unless we have enough knowledge, we should not proceed with this activity. There's also other, this is a WWF slide, but in fact the sort of requirements or for lifting of a moratorium or a precautionary pause are quite similar in many of the other calls as well by other organizations, by states and by companies. So this has to do with the risks, that we know the risks to the environment and social risk and economic risks of and embarking on this new unknown activity, demonstrate that it doesn't harm the marine environment as per the Law of the Sea Convention and prevents biodiversity loss, and where it's relevant that indigenous people and local communities are being consulted and consent, but also that alternatives to these minerals are explored, so we do not just open another linear extraction process, but instead look at the whole issue around the supply and demand for minerals. Public consultation mechanisms in place, because this is the common heritage of humankind. And of course also that the International Seabed Authority is a modern and transparent institution in which we as citizens have insight. There are obviously some issues around companies and their intellectual property rights, but apart from that, there's a lot more that can be done around transparency at the International Seabed Authority. So these are some of the conditions for, if a moratorium is in place, when it could be lifted. But we are very far from that discussion at the ISA today.
Only dare to press this button anymore.
Oh, there we go. So at the moment, we have 32 countries are calling for a pause, a moratorium, or a ban. There was zero in the beginning of June 2 years ago. The first set of countries came onto this platform at the UN Ocean Conference in Lisbon in 2022. And we added more countries, five, at this assembly meeting in July. So this is a growing movement with various wordings to what they would like to see. But in general, what it means, please slow down. Please let us know more about the deep sea before we embark on this new industry. There are also other organizations and entities that are joining this call. We have over 800 scientists from across the world who are calling for a moratorium to let the science do its job. And this is not only deep sea scientists, it's also fishery scientists and others. And also we have now many companies that have signed a pledge not to source any minerals from the deep sea should mining start, and calling for a moratorium because they're worried about the wider implications for the planet of seabed mining. So this is a few of those outside of the ISA happenings, but which have an impact on the discussions at the ISA as well. And then just to round off this, I just wanted to put the seabed mining issue into a larger context as we are in a workshop environment here. Governments have spoken out against seabed mining in other fora, for example, at the Convention on Migratory Species recently. The CMS issued a statement that they would like to make sure that seabed mining is not impacting migratory species. UNEP's finance initiative has guarded against investments in the industry. The Global Tuna Alliance, which is grouping the major tuna retailers in the world, so a very important economic group in the fisheries world, have called for a moratorium because of the risk to fisheries from this new activity. As I mentioned, indigenous peoples are calling for a precaution and pause and even a ban. The European Parliament, to bring it back to the topic or the sort of the topic of this whole course, has several times voted for a moratorium. And then there are other issues like I suppose, but I don't know the Green Deal so well, so I'm looking forward to hearing more about that. But in the EU, we have the Critical Minerals Act, we have acts around circular economy, etc., that are also important, that also touch upon this issue. So there's a lot of different other developments around this topic, which is, I think, is important, because I think it's important to understand that and you know this, the law of the sea is a tool. It's not something that can be used in a vacuum. Governments and negotiators have to think about the bigger picture when they make these big decisions. We have also BBNJ that was mentioned earlier by Andre, where in particular the environmental impact assessment part will be very important for potential seabed mining. The UN Human Rights Commissioner has cautioned against seabed mining and criticized the ISA for not taking indigenous peoples' voices in more into account. And of course, we have the Global Biodiversity Framework, which sets an agenda for the world to protect and preserve biodiversity across the planet, not just in the ocean. And then we have other technology was being mentioned. Technology is moving very, very fast, and many of these presumed uses for these minerals are starting to become obsolete because batteries are using other processes. They're not using these minerals, for example. So I think we can see a big change in the next few years around this topic, both on the legal side, but also on the side of, you know, what does the world really think about this? I think I have two more slides, but I think that this slide here, I will leave it with you because it's a bit detailed, but it's really what the circular economy can do in order to prevent not only seabed mining, but also reduce mining in sensitive areas across the planet. So I'm sure you'll get these presentations at the end of the class. So I leave that with you for that. And then I just wanted to end with a question that you can think about, which is the role for the EU in seabed mining is interesting because the EU doesn't have delegated responsibility at the ISA as it does for BBNJ and as it does for fisheries, for example. Each member state negotiates on their own behalf as a state party to the Law of the Sea Convention at the ISA. But there are other things that the EU can do, that the Commission can do, Parliament, I mentioned, Council, and then individual member states alone or together. And I think here, perhaps in particular, I would point out promote science and invest in science so that we know what we're talking about, but then also, of course, on alternatives to these minerals from the deep sea. And then I'm looking forward to hearing more about the Green Deal, so I'm hoping there'll be some connections there as well. With that, thank you so much.